we have some wise people here? Yes. What is wisdom? Talk to me. What is wisdom? Every answer in church is the right answer. Yes, sir. The right application of knowledge. Perfect. Thank you. That's a good dictionary. Any other wisdom? Any other wise person? We have one. Any wise woman? Yes, sir. The ability to make right decision. Perfect. Good English. Any other? Any wise person around? Suriza jiraniago kumbe tunafanana. You know, kumbe. You know. What is wisdom? Yes. Becoming like what you know. Good. Any other person, wisdom? If somebody was to confront you and say, when you say, I am wise, what are you saying? When you say, I'm the wisdom of God, what are you saying? You are full of knowledge. Uh-huh. Another wise person here? When the Bible says a wise woman, what does it mean? Do we have some wise women here? What does it mean? Can you express what you mean by you are wise? Oh, they have resigned. Any wise man? The Bible says wisdom build a house. By the way, do you realize wisdom is called a she? It's not a he. From the word principle wisdom, wisdom is what you have become by virtue of knowledge. It's not only what you know, it is what you've become. That's why wisdom is not a description of information, it's a person. Wisdom is a person. It's what you've become. It's the she aspect in you. They say women have sixth sense. They are able to discern. But if there are people who are trapped more than the rest, are the sixth sense people. And you wonder, where was your sixth sense? How can you be confused with sixth sense by a man who has five senses? And all they have is the common senses. Smelling, seeing, touch, testing, hearing, all that. How can a man with common sense confuse a woman who has a sixth sense? The sixth sense is called what? Before it becomes wisdom. What is it? Discernment. It's discernment. Women carry discernment. Women know it beforehand what is about to happen.
And when you don't pray, yes.
Okay, yes. Now, mommy is bringing the other aspect of wisdom. When wisdom is not redeemed, it becomes perverse. Perverted sensitivity, discernment becomes suspicion. Now, most women operate on perverted wisdom, suspicion. Na kitu iliniambia, nina suspect kuna kakitu. Now, that is fallen nature. Now, mtu kama huyo na pasaria wana tofauti. Because they're able to pick issues, but from a different spirit. So, the problem that we have right now is, how many of you know that palm readers can tell you the future? They're able to tell the future, but with the wrong spirit. How many have ever had people who are able to, familiar spirit. Now, familiar spirit is, the word familiar from that description is, it's a spirit that is able to identify what is happening, what has happened. Ulikula nini lunch, ukuko na nguo ngapi. It's a familiar spirit, but it's an evil spirit. Now, most people operate in that. People who live in suspicion operate under perverse wisdom. Now, wisdom is the ability in you to walk in discernment, sensitivity positively. For example, this is how wisdom and discernment, this is how wisdom in terms of discernment and suspicion work. Suspicion says, this man, this woman could be up to something, and I feel there's something wrong. This is what suspicion does. Avoid them. Ataniliona tu nikuwe wise, nimuondoke. Now, that's how suspicion response. Wisdom looks for a solution. That's why he says the ability to know the right thing and do it. So wisdom picks the problem but gives solution. Suspicion picks the problem but creates an offense. fight or put a wall to avoid. Now listen, God gave you discernment to solve problems, not that you can smell on everybody's problems and avoid them. A problem you avoid, let me say it in other words, if you avoid a problem, you are not better than the carrier. Because they carry it, you know it. Tell your neighbor, they carry it, you know it. And the worst part of it is, if you have to tell somebody, a problem gave you the discernment to solve it. And you end up telling somebody who doesn't have the discernment and doesn't have the solution. That's why I say, do not dwell in the counsel of the wicked. Mockers. That's what the Bible says. There is a conversation, there is a behavior, there is a way people live. And the Bible, the scriptures calls it, this is not a wisdom from above. It's earthly, it's sensual, it's demonic. It has a way of picking what is true, but the frequency is wrong. It's piracy. So, having said that, let's go back to Jesus. Jesus increased in wisdom. Jesus increased in wisdom. Look at the wisdom of Jesus. He would pick what people need and create a solution right there and then. He knew exactly who to heal. He did not heal everybody because his wisdom was able to detect. Listen to the description of his assignment. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, anointed me. But listen, as much as you are anointed, you are not anointed to solve everything. Wisdom now helps you to know the right thing to do. So as much as you are walking in grace, you don't walk carelessly. That's what the Bible talks about. Don't take the grace of God for granted. For example, you can't say, I have the grace of God. I have the wisdom of God. I can still go to a nightclub and drink up to here. And I will wisely shut my mouth. As long as I don't abuse everybody. Now listen, knowledge that is not grace makes people crafty. Because they twist the truth to satisfy. Have you ever been arrested by the police and they read you the scriptures? The scriptures that says, the Bible says, sort out issues with your accuser before you get to court. Before you meet the judge. It's scriptures, but perverted. How many of you have ever perverted wisdom sometimes back to get out of a problem? Talk to me. How many of you have ever perverted? Yes, you know what you're doing? What you are doing is, you did not have what we call the maturity to withstand the challenge. The Bible talks about Jesus was able to give everybody an answer. That's what Paul tells Timothy. He says you should develop the capacity that whenever there is a question or a challenge, you should be ready to give an answer. You are wise. You are wise. So the grace of God has everything we need, but we grow into. Jesus increased in wisdom. The ability to administer the principles of the kingdom graciously. That's why Jesus was able to answer questions, was able to evade traps, was able to heal people. For example, when the Samaritan woman issue came up, and there was a contention about whether it was right for the Samaritan woman to be healed because they were considered as dogs. Jesus wisely was able to navigate the wisdom of God to bring solution. I gave you a story. I think it was a story I gave you here sometimes back. You remember this woman that was caught in adultery? The Bible says when they got her, they brought her to Jesus. But the Bible emphasized the intention was to test him. They wanted to question his wisdom. So the Bible says when they brought to Jesus, Jesus did not accuse. He stooped down and began to write. Of course, there are a lot of theories that have come out of how they write people. They say they write the name of one of the accusers, plus the woman they normally, you know, they write the name of this one. And do you remember so and so? You know, so everybody saw my name, and then Nani, my name. And then the Bible says by the time you woke up, everybody was gone. Those are theories that has come out because everybody's mistake was written. But forget about that. But the principle was, if the Bible says we got her in the very act. Now look at the human mind, perverted mind. The law said the woman is guilty. The man is free. Because if you got her in the very act, there were two. But the law said it is the woman who is guilty. So, Jesus, I'm sure Jesus would have said in his heart, if you stoned her where you found her, the law would have approved and justified your action. But now you brought her to the court of grace. Grace says, this sinful nature was sorted out before you committed. So you have no sin. So he said, if any of you have no sin, let them be the first one to throw the stone. Not everybody. The one that has no sin, be the one to. You know what he was telling them? Anybody that is living in grace. You know what they would have done? They would have all lifted their hands and received the love of God. The principle is, he had the wisdom to navigate. That's what maturity is. The wisdom to navigate. It's not spiritual craftiness. Look at our description of wisdom. Atimini likuwa too wise. Nikaamani chenyamasi. Now, that's not wisdom. Wisdom is your ability to give an answer that sorts out the problem. Not stepping backward and say, you know, in some places, it's good to be wise. Now, let me give you a better word for that description. The best word for that description is being crafty. You don't have the solution, so you hope to stand aside. Wisdom is the ability to bring solutions to every and any situation. That's wisdom. Anything you can give a solution is not hard. It's only that you have not matured in grace to solve it. Everything has an answer. Everything has a solution. If it is a mountain to you, it's because. I think somebody said a statement like this. Somebody said, there is no mountain anywhere. Every man's ignorance is their mountain. Let me give you an example. When we had our first car, I tried to encourage mom to drive. Because sometimes I'll travel and she needs to go around. But she literally refused to. And the excuse she gave me was, the road is too small and the vehicle is too big. Anaona gari imejaa kwa barabara, so anaona atakongana na magari mengine. Of course, it's a long story. So what I did, I bought her own car. And I made sure, no lift. Nobody will enter my car except the Chapman. Mom is driving today, right into Nairobi. Why? The demand to navigate around the problem put a demand on her to grow. Not that she couldn't drive. It's only that the capacity would not. So the demand gave her the solution. How many of you have ended up doing things you thought you wouldn't do? You know why? The reason why you wouldn't do is because there wasn't enough pressure. But you can shift from pressure and join grace. So what am I trying to say? The grace of God flows to the level of your maturity. The grace of God flows on the avenue of maturity. There's an atmosphere called maturity. Listen to the language of Jesus to the disciples. He says, I no longer call you servants. I call you friends. What is he talking about? Maturity. Before Jesus left, the Bible says, He told the disciples to go to the upper room and wait for the promise, which was the Holy Spirit. Who is the Holy Spirit? It's the grace of God packaged in the personality of the Holy Spirit. Why? When he comes on you, he will help you to do all things. That's why it's very hard to do any divine principle or practice divine life, the life of faith, the life of Christ, the life of salvation, minus the grace of God, which is transmitted by the person of the Holy Spirit. That's why without the Holy Spirit, you can't live the life of grace. Because the administrator of this season of grace is the Holy Spirit. You can't pray without the Holy Spirit. You can't understand the word without the Holy Spirit. You can't worship without the Holy Spirit. You can't serve without the Holy Spirit. You can't be saved without the Holy Spirit. You can't remain in faith without the Holy Spirit. You can't have faith without the Holy Spirit. You can't transmit the fruit without the Holy Spirit. After all, it's even called the fruit of the Spirit. That brings this conclusion. Our relationship with the administrator of grace is wanting. Our relationship with the administrator of grace is wanting. Number two, our knowledge to the administrator of grace is wanting. We don't even know who he is. We call it an it. We call it something. Something told me. Something prompted me. Number three, our relationship with the administrator of grace is wanting. Let me ask you a question. When was the last time you had a conversation with the Holy Spirit? The Holy Spirit. There's a book I want to recommend if you can get it, or if you want it, talk to me, I'll get it for you. Written by Ben Hinn, Good Morning, Holy Spirit. If you can get it, get it. If you don't know how to get it, please, I can get it for you. Good morning, Holy Spirit. There's a book I also want to recommend by Mike Murdock. Mike Murdock writes about the most important person in my life, the person of the Holy Spirit. The most important person in my life, the Holy Spirit. You know what I'm trying to say? The administrator of grace is the Holy Spirit. We rarely have the right knowledge about it. We've learned a lot about the Father, the Son, very few about the Holy Spirit. By the way, who resides in you? Who lives in you? How many are saved? Anybody saved in the house? When you say I'm saved, who resides in you? Jesus or the Father? All of them. The Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Holy Ghost is the administrator of salvation. You are saved because the Holy Spirit came to put a rubber stamp. But you know what? We rarely engage him. We talk to Jesus. We pray in the name of Jesus. We do everything in Jesus. Jesus, lead me. And Jesus is like, I am not on duty. It's the Holy Spirit. I want you to try it this way. Every time you want to pray, engage the Holy Spirit. See how far you can swim in prayer. Okay? Actually, let me tell you something. When you engage the frequency of the Holy Spirit, you confuse the devil. Warfare becomes very easy. It's very easy. Why? You are in a frequency where the enemy cannot access. But try prayer without the administrator. It's as dry as you can tell. Unaweza pika story na mtu enye aielekei mahali. Unaona story enye aina mahali. Unaweza ongea your story na hakuna kitu. But when you try to engage God, let me give you a very good example. How many have ever seen or have done it, read novels this size? Have you ever seen people read novels this size? Haina mali nitoka, hakuna mali inaenda. Nika story, a clever description of somebody. How many read novels? How many read novels? How many know people who read novels? You do. How many of us struggle reading the Bible like me? I said, how many struggle reading the Bible? For example, me. So we are many. You know what the problem is? the Holy Spirit. I mean, the Bible is not human understanding. The Bible says the scriptures are God's breath, written by holy men, inspired by the Holy Spirit. So it takes the Holy Spirit to understand the Bible. Somebody told me there's part of the Bible that should not be in the Bible, Leviticus. You know what they were saying in simple words? I don't have a relationship with the Holy Spirit. How many of you have ever read about the genealogy of Jesus? So-and-so begets so-and-so, and so-and-so begets so-and-so, and so-and-so begets so. Have you ever read those things? Very boring. Why? It's a spiritual frequency. The scriptures makes no sense if you try to understand here. Let me prove it to you. Most of you still remember what you learned in primary school, high school, physics, chemistry. You still remember those. But what I taught you last week, you don't remember. Why? Because the things of the Holy Spirit are understood here. The things in school are understood here. You can grab this one, but this one has to be revealed. Now, the things you learned in school, the things in the head, has only one meaning. What it meant, that is what it means. The things in the heart can mean many things at different times. Because it's about the revelation in it. It takes the Holy Spirit to live a life of grace. Now, when Paul says, I no longer live, he's talking about the government of the Holy Spirit. Now, this is still very basic on the class of grace. But the administrator of grace is the Holy Spirit. Now, the Bible says, do not quench the Holy Spirit. Do not quench the Holy Spirit. Say that with me. Not quench the Holy Spirit. Say it again. Now, what does that mean? When you quench the Holy Spirit, you quench the flow of grace. You shut the river of grace. I finish by saying this. The enemy's intention is to create scenarios in you that quenches the Holy Spirit. Simple. Our thoughts, our behaviors, our languages, our relationship, our actions, all of them have a tendency of quenching the Holy Spirit. I'll give you a very good example. If you are hurting and you find it so hard to forgive, that becomes a cloth in the frequency, on the line where grace will flow. I want to give you a recommendation. It doesn't matter who hurts you, on what platform, the depth of the heart, how much you are bleeding. The flow of grace is more important than any stupid feeling of being hurt. Because the thing that affects you flows through your blood system. You don't want hurtings to be part of your flow. Let me prove it to you. How many of you realize you get more hurt when you are alone than when you are with a person who hurt you? I know you understand English. Yes. How many of you mnajua mtu mwenye alikuumiza haumiangi sana mkiwa na yeye kuliko wakati uko peke yako? Ukiwa peke yako ndio unaanza kuumia. Unaona misisi inamea hapa. Usingizi unapika teki usiku. Why? You have allowed it into your system. Can I give you a wisdom? Learn to forgive easily. The only way you can do it is, instead of keeping the hurtings, break the relationship. It saves you. Instead of keeping the hurt, break the relationship. So that you don't have avenues to meet again. Protect your heart. Guard your heart. But some people leave the very person who hurt you on the street, but they go with the effect back home. Unafika nyumbani, mzee wako anakungojea, mke wako anakungojea, watoto anakungojea. Hey, mami, umekuja. It's like, wewe naye toka mbele yangu ama ni kunyonge. Mpaka watu wenye wako na namna, mpaka pusi kwa nyumba, anajuanga mood zako. You know? Pusi anajua wakati uko na amani na wakati una. Kuna wakati unakuja hivi pusi na doki wanajua, leo madhe ana maneno. Unaona wanafanya mkia hivi. Na kuna siku anakuja akikuta kwa keto akiona, hey, hey, hey. Kumba ni stress ya mtu mwingine. You know? Introduce surrender to the person of the Holy Spirit. And our walk with the Holy Spirit was in the, I mean, is in the platform of maturity. All right? Platform called what? Maturity. So the grace of God, the atmosphere of grace, is the atmosphere of maturity. And Lord, we thank you tonight. Lift your hand and just thank God. Ask the Holy Spirit to come into your heart and take control, transact the affairs of your life. Come on, talk to him. Tell him, Holy Spirit, I want you to take control over my life. Help me to pray. Everybody talk to the Holy Spirit. I can't pray without you. I can't read the word without you. Actually, I can't be saved without you. I can't walk without you. Holy Spirit, submit to you. Submit to you, Lord. I submit to you, Lord. Submit to you, Lord. Lord, we thank you tonight. Thank you tonight. We thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name. I want to recommend to you, before you pray, before you sleep, before you read the scriptures, before you go to church, before you come to a service like this, engage the Holy Spirit. I sang a song about the Holy Spirit, and he said, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Or I can't even walk without you holding my hands. He said, because the mountain is so high, too high, and the mountain is so low. He said, if you are not coming with me, I can't even move without you holding my hand. When David says, restore to me the joy of your salvation, he says, do not take away your spirit from me. Because when you take the spirit from me, my walk of faith becomes useless. Stand on your feet.
Today they might fall. Now as to God we're confessing. Now as on Jesus we call.